Welcome to the Thunderbolts.info podcast for March 4th, 2016. If you've been following the work of the Thunderbolts Project for some time, you've become aware of some very different concepts about how the universe works. A lot of the theories of the standard cosmology, which include invisible, hypothetical phenomena or entities, such as black holes and dark matter, are not included in the electric universe theory. And one of the things that the electric universe sees very differently than mainstream astronomy is the hypothesis of something called a neutron star. Now, scientists observe in deep space these regularly periodic pulsing signals of energy, which they call pulsars. It was back in the 1960s that scientists first detected this kind of pulsing radio signal, and for a time they actually believed the source might be an extraterrestrial intelligence. But in response to this discovery, the hypothesis of a neutron star was invented. This is the idea that the material left over from a supernova explosion of a massive star will collapse gravitationally, and it forms a very small and incredibly dense star, which is mostly composed of tightly packed neutrons. And supposedly a rotating neutron star is the source of these regular pulses of radio waves. Well, on our series, Space News from the Electric Universe, we have discussed a number of discoveries that, in effect, falsify the neutron star hypothesis. In fact, it happens that the most viewed space news we've posted is a report entitled, Impossible Neutron Star Shatters Theory. This was a story about a so-called neutron star that supposedly shines with the brightness of 10 million suns. And because this video has received close to 200,000 views, and it's gotten the attention of a number of advocates of standard cosmology. It has also received the most intense backlash of negative comments of any space news to date. A lot of these comments are pure ad hominem, and that's not entirely surprising given that it is the YouTube comment section. So one of the guests featured in this video was our friend and colleague, Dr. Tom Wilson. And recently, we offered Tom the opportunity to formulate a reply to some of the comments that have been posted on this video. And I think this is good because there are a lot of misconceptions about the electric universe that we see on the internet, and it wouldn't be possible for the Thunderbolts Project to offer a direct rebuttal to each misrepresentation. So I'm going to play for you now the statement that Tom has recorded, so he can tell you in his own words his thoughts on some of the reactions we've seen in response to his space news report.
One of the comments to the video we're discussing asked about the meaning of technology executive. Basically, I define that as someone who looks after tens of millions or hundreds of millions of dollars of product sales and development. That's certainly true in my case, but I also have a science background and an interest in the psychology of science. But I tend to come at this whole debate as essentially a business guy. In business, you need to be ruthlessly rational. It always comes down to results. If some idea is not yielding results, you scrap it and you move on to whatever does get you results. And I'm not afraid of crackpot ideas. Some of the most crackpot ideas can change markets, redefine the way people interact with the world, and make lots of money. So I am inherently, by training and by inclination, very open to crazy ideas if they can be shown to yield results. Remember, it's all about getting results. Period. So let me put this whole discussion into the form of a story that maybe people can relate to, and it might help diffuse the emotions a little bit. Say, for argument's sake, there's this manager, and he has a product. Software, hardware, doesn't matter really, a product is a product. But he's got himself a problem. The problem is, he gets complaints every week, sometimes daily, about how the user manual for the product does not predict the way the product works. It's doing all these things that the user manual says should be clearly impossible. Now, he's got himself something called a buggy product. In this case, based on the ongoing reports of the product's apparently impossible behavior, it's very buggy. Now, in his business, he has to issue something called errata sheets. These errata sheets describe what are called workarounds for the bug. Workarounds say things like, don't use the product under these conditions or the product's behavior cannot be guaranteed, etc. Now, the team who has been responsible for the documentation of the product, call them Team A, are issuing errata sheets and workarounds constantly. He keeps getting reports across his desk of the increasing list of bugs being identified, customer complaints about their dissatisfaction in the product, and the stream of errata sheets piling up so much that the list of errata is getting bigger than the user manual itself. It's not good, and it has to change. So he calls in Team A to find out what's going on. Now, Team A is a bunch of nice guys. It's a huge team, and they practically fill all of the conference room. They're very earnest and passionate about what they do, and in some cases, they're very distinguished. But they're also very theoretical. They live in a world of mathematical models and computer simulations, and also tend to be a bit high-strung. Regardless, he values their contribution and knows they can generate some pretty interesting ideas. But honestly, he has been shoveling a ton of money and funding and resources their way, and he's not entirely happy with the results. So they start drawing him a lot of very pretty pictures and some very impressive mathematical formulations. But he has to tell them, look, that's all very well and good, but why are we seeing the product continue to behave in ways the user manual cannot predict? Something's wrong. Well, they propose more funding to get at what they would call the root cause of the unpredictable behavior. They're convinced, certain even, that they are on the right track and just need more time and money. Now, just to be sure he's getting the whole picture, the manager has also invited Team B. Team B is really just a couple guys who have been looking at this problem in their spare time. The thing about Team B, though, is they're engineers. They're very practical, used to building things that don't break. One guy on Team B puts up his hand and says, look, boss, I've got this idea, but I just know you and Team A are going to think it's completely nuts. But frankly, with this idea, what seems to be unpredictable behavior in the product actually fits. So they outline the premise of their crazy idea. And Team A goes nuts. I mean, emotional, they're angry, and they start abusing these two poor guys from Team B who are really just trying to help. Now, the manager regards himself as a good leader, and he knows his people. He knows that Team A is not normally like this. They're nice guys. They raise families. They're nice to dogs, and so on. But he also understands the psychology of certainty and change. He's got on-the-job and formal training on human psychology under these conditions. He's read the neuroscience research, like with the scarf model and change management, that clearly shows that a perceived threat to one's certainty and social position elicits the same neurochemical response as an actual physical threat. So he understands why Team A is behaving the way they are. He gets it. But it's not productive, and it sure isn't going to get results. It's all about results. So he asks Team A to just pipe down, and he gets the two guys from Team B to talk him through their idea just a bit more. Now, he has to admit it's pretty crazy, improbable even, but he can't deny that what they outline fits with what he's seeing in the field. In addition, the basic premise of the idea is founded on solid engineering. They cite research from IEEE journals. He knows the guys in Team A have not had the training or the opportunity to even be aware of these journals. It just wouldn't be part of their academic curriculum, so he doesn't blame them for that. But while the essential math and theory is there for Team B, it's never really been applied to this specific problem, and there would be a lot of work to flesh it out. So he asks Team B what they would need to make progress. Now, one guy in Team B says, well, we've only really had a chance to sketch this out at a high level, but we think it's promising. Tell you what, give us just 1% of what you're paying Team A to let us put some more work into this and develop a more detailed model. Then we'll be able to say more about how valid this approach really is. So what does the manager do? Well, he's a business guy. He likes to hedge his bets. He's all about risk management, and he wisely embraces crazy ideas as long as they yield results. So here's what he does. He lets Team A keep doing what they're doing, but at 95% funding. Be honest, they're not giving him great results, but they are likely to be Plan A for some time. And there are the errata sheets that he has to take care of, and those apparently are not going away anytime soon. But he also gives Team B 5% of Team A's funding. Now, it's more than Team B asked for, but he tells them they're going to get more because he wants it done faster than they proposed. Time is money, and he can't tolerate a buggy product. So let's be clear. To succeed in any business, you cannot get emotionally attached to any idea, any product, ever. nothing is certain. You must always weigh everything on the value of the results you get from it. Period. Now, I understand the human psychology of change. I've led change many times in my career. I've read books like those by John Cotter and others on the process of change management. Now, Cotter talks about how in change management you have three groups of people, basically. There is one group who is always open to ideas and will assess the value of the change based on its merits. They will line up behind the change and support it if it's rational. And there's a second group who are on the fence. They're reluctant, but can be convinced depending on how the whole group behaves. Then there is the third group who will resist change at all costs. You would never, ever enlist group three to support the change. In change management, then, you identify group one and you get them on board. Then you look for individuals in group two and bring them along with you using the help of group one as internal champions. But you completely ignore group three. They will never be convinced, so you waste zero effort on trying to do so. Now, it is interesting that the list of comments to this video is actually a fair mix of these three groups. I find that interesting. Now, all I can say is that I believe in the what if question. I believe in being open to crazy ideas, even what might be called crackpot ideas, as long as they yield results. I have no bias. I just want answers.